Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. Ya Rabbana laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa li azimi sultanika. Subhanaka la nuhsi thana'ana laka anta kama athnayta ala nafsik. O our Lord, praise is yours as is becoming of the magnificence of your countenance and the greatness of your power. Glory to you, we cannot praise you as you have praised yourself. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa ala abaihi wa ikhwanihi min al-anbiya'i wal-mursaleen. And we ask Allah to send His mercy, magnification, and salutations upon the best of creation, as well as His family, companions, all of His forefathers and brothers of all prophets and messengers. Salata ahli samawati wa ahli al-ard wa afina wa tufbina fi yamurina kulliha wa ajri ya rabbana lutfaka al-khafiyya fi umurina wa umur al-muslimin wa sallam taslima. And we ask Allah that these salawat and salams be along with those and as those of all of the heavens and all of the earth. We ask Allah for wellness for all of us, and that Allah gives us His lutf, His divine kindness and gentleness in all of our affairs, and that He causes that to flow in all our affairs, the affairs of those present, and the affairs of all of the Muslims, those who surrender to Him. And we ask Allah that these also be upon all who follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam in goodness, and that they be upon us with that group and among that group by Allah's mercy, and Allah is the most merciful of the merciful. And we praise you, Ya Rabbana, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. We praise you, O Allah, O Lord of the worlds, a praise by which we ask you that those rains of tawfiq not miss us, and that you make us mentioned and in the hearts of an ala baal ahlillah. And alhamdulillah, we thank Allah that He's allowed us to come here again. It's been a couple of years since I've been honored by the presence with you all in the Virtues Tour. It's beautiful to see these young people, elders, families. We thank Allah for bringing us together, and we thank Allah that He brought us to one more Rabi al-Awwal and Laylat al-Jumu'ah of Rabi al-Awwal, the eve before Friday in this blessed month of Rabi al-Awwal, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, "Akthiru min as-salati alayhi Laylat al-Zahra wa al-Yawm al-Azhar fa inna salatakum tu'radu alayh." Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Make many salawat, send many prayers upon me, invoke many prayers upon me in the radiant night and the bright day." The radiant night is this night, Thursday night, the night before Jumu'ah, and the bright day is tomorrow, Yawm al-Jumu'ah. And then he informed us of the reason for that, and he said, "For surely your prayers are shown to me." It comes in a riwayah of Ibn Majah, and this is from Friday. Where we are now is from Jumu'ah. It's Laylat al-Jumu'ah, and it is Jumu'ah in some of the Muslim lands, that on Friday, as long as a servant is sending salawat upon the Prophet Muhammad, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa baraka alayhi wa alayhi, they're being shown to him. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to say many prayers and pure prayers and blessed prayers, and prayers that are excellent and received in their presentation before Al-Habib, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala alayhi. And we're discussing difficult years in the life of our beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Inshallah, we'll discuss the most difficult day of his mission, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala alihi. And last night, we studied and explored some of the meanings of the year, and this, we're in the year. We're still in the year that he referred to as Aam al-Huzn, the year of sorrow, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. When his beloved wife Sayyidatina Khadija passed to the highest company, the flight of Our Lady, Sayyidatina Khadija bint Khuwaylid, his first wife, the mother of all of his surviving children, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala alihi. We also mentioned the passing of that great lover, protector, supporter, nobleman of Bani Abd al-Muttalib, Sayyidina Abu Talib, rahimahullah, and he passed 3 days before the passing of Sayyidina Khadija, radiyallahu anha wa ardaha. Also in this phase, we have the marriage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam to his beloved wife Sayyidatina Aisha, as well as his beloved wife Sayyidatuna Sauda bint Zam'a. And when we look at the marriage and the life and the love of Al-Habib Al-A'zam, of our greatest love, to Sayyidatina Khadija, in this we're seeing an archetype for all of humanity and all of history of marriage and what marriage can be. As he said, Ruziqtu hubbaha. She supported me, she believed in me when people disbelieved in me, affirmed me when people denied me, gave to me when people deprived me, gave me children when Allah deprived me of children from other women, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he said, ruziqtu hubbaha. I was provided or sustained with her love. But if we look at her marriage, and also we look at these other marriages, we might find that many of the things, many of the standards, the i'tibarat, the considerations, the customs that some of us might adhere to almost as if they're law, they didn't exist and they were different in those marriages. Sayyidatuna Khadija radiyallahu anha wa ardaha was married twice prior to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala alayhi. She was widowed twice prior to her marriage to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. She had 3 children prior to her marriage from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Hind, Abi Hala, those were both male, and another Hind who was female. She was his senior. Radiallahu anha wa ardaha, being 40 and he being 25. She proposed to him. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa la alayhi. So those of us, for example, who wouldn't allow our sons to marry a woman who had been previously married, or we wouldn't marry a woman who had been previously married, or those of us that wouldn't marry a woman with children, or those of us, especially speaking to young men, that wouldn't marry a woman that was older than us. Where are we from these archetypes? Arguably, we could say she is the supreme woman, the supreme woman of Jannah. And I say arguably, and we're aware of the difference of opinion between her and her daughter and her and Sayyidatina Maryam. But the point is, from the greatest of women, married to the greatest of creation, that defines marriage. So anyone that says, don't marry any woman that's not been married, and Nabi Muhammad married a woman that was married. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Akhi, are you better or he? Where are you compared to him? Say, don't marry a woman that's older than you. And Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married a woman that was substantially his senior. Don't marry a woman with children. That Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married women with children. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala. Whose measures are we adhering to? What defines our culture, our custom? What defines for us right and wrong? Really, in this age, this is an age where haq itself, reality itself, is challenged. These babies, and on my side of the pond we call kids babies, not to insult the little boys. These young men, if they go to school, they're going to face an environment that's challenging truths, undeniable, physical, empirically substantiated truths. Like that someone who's born with male equipment is a little boy. Someone who's born with female, a female body is a girl. So you could decide, I'm a boy, I'm a girl. There's no such thing as truth. So then how is the Ummah of Muhammad in this time, as if we should have in any time, going to look any further than the beloved of our Rahman, that one who has discussed in the early nights of virtues, said of himself, and this is a riwayah of al-Bukhari, with no ziyada of fil manam in Bukhari's riwayah, man ra'ani faqad ra'a al-haq. Who's ever seen me has seen the truth. The one of whom Allah said when he entered Mecca, wa qul ja'a al-haq wa zahaq al-batil. Inna al-batila kana zahuqa. Truth has come and falsehood has perished. Surely falsehood is perishing. He brought the truth. You could say he is the truth, as we say in the Sahih Dua of Tahajjud, wa Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, haq. How can we look further than the haq for a way forward for our community? How can we let manhood, womanhood, this sacred institution of marriage be defined by those that have desecrated the institution of marriage, desecrated our very humanity, have desecrated the institution of marriage by saying marriage is something you could have two men marry, two women marry, two its marry, non-binary, I'm non-binary, I don't call myself anything, go ahead and just anything marry anyone. We were joking with the brothers, some people are trans species. Amir was saying, they say, I'm a wolf. I'm trans, that's where it's gotten. But should we laugh or should we cry because many Muslims are surrendering our minds and our hearts and our babies to that civilization to teach them right from wrong? May Allah give us to follow Nabi Muhammad who said, An-nikah min sunnati. An-nikah, marriage is from my sunnah and the sunnah of all prophets before me. Anyone who desires other than my sunnah is not from me. And similarly, with the passing of Sayyidatina Khadija, and we've heard it, people want to define that marriage and define that narrative as if it's a Hollywood love story or a romantic novel. That story would say after his great love, he could never marry again and whoop-de-whoop-de-woo. That's not how it was. That is not the narrative of a Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The narrative of a Nabi Muhammad, Allahumma salli wa sallam wa baraka alayhi wa alihi, is that after the passing of Sayyidatina Khadija, one of the Sahabiyat, Sayyidatuna Khawla bint Hakim, Khawla bint Hakim, who was the wife of who? The wife of Uthman bin Mad'un, not Affan bin Mad'un, was the emir of the first hijrah to Abyssinia. Khawla comes to the Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallama and says, wouldn't you marry? And he said, who? She said, either a virgin or a woman who had been previously married. Khawla, this matchmaker, offered to him two of the women of his community. He said, which one? Which virgin, which unmarried girl, and which woman that's been previously married? She said, as for the unmarried girl, the daughter of the most beloved of people to you, Aisha bint Abi Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, anhuma. And as for the woman that's been previously married, Sayyidatuna Sauda bint Zam'a. So what did Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? Did he say, oh, after my great love, I can't marry anyone? No, he didn't say that. Did he say, I can only marry one because that's right? He didn't say that. And we should look here. And those of us that have a little bit of experience with this prophetic injunction can see the perfection in what he did next. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is the meaning we've benefited from Shaykh Ibrahim hafidhahullah, perfection as azib. As a bachelor, we see perfection. Total chastity. Total temperance, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, keeping himself chaste, unmarried, a virgin himself, until he was 25. In the days of the courtship of he and Sayyidatina Khadija, they said they never saw a young man that was shyer than him. Perfection, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that phase. Then we see the phase of his marriage to Sayyidatina Khadija, perfection in a marriage between one man and one woman. In the next phase also, we see perfection in plural marriage. And those of us that know something about this sunnah know that one of the most difficult parts of it is when a wife has a lengthy time with her husband to herself and he marries an additional wife. It's very hard on her feelings. It's very difficult for her feelings. For some sisters, devastating. And they won't recover from it. Any brothers who practice that, you have to understand that. You're going to watch extreme hurt in your wife, which means you have to be extremely gentle and extremely caring to her. Don't just tell her, you know, sister, it's sunnah, what's your problem? It's extremely heavy on the heart of a woman. The Prophet ﷺ never did that to any of the mothers of believers. None of them had him to themselves and then suddenly had to share him. So what did he do next in this hadith? And this hadith is narrated in the Sahih. It's narrated by Hakim on the Shart of Muslim, and al-Dhahabi concurred. He said, go mention me to both of them. Sayyidatina Khawla, on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ, with his request, proposed to both Sayyidatina Aisha bint Abi Bakr as-Siddiq and Sayyidatuna Sauda bint Zama. So she goes and she proposes. And again, can't help you. I can't apologize. Doesn't need any explanation. This is marriage. Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his sacred law, the book revealed upon him, the sunnah that he demonstrated, defines right and wrong, defines truth, defines goodness, defines beauty. So he went from perfection, beauty, goodness, ma'roof, righteousness in monogamy to beauty, perfection, goodness, righteousness in plural marriage. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak alayhi wa ala alayhi. So Sayyidatina Khawla, she went and proposed. First to Sayyidatina Aisha, and it's a long hadith for brevity's sake. We won't mention all of it. And she was married to him. And then Sayyidatina Khawla left from completing the marriage to Sayyidatina Aisha and went to the father, and he was an old man, still in Jahiliyyah, of Sayyidatina Sauda, proposed on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were married, ending the phase of his being married to this one wife, opening the phase essentially simultaneously to him being married to multiple wives, the mothers of the believers. With that marriage, particularly the marriage to Sayyidatina Aisha, from that marriage and from those marriages, and again, the standard, any standard other than Nubuwwah, it should be against the wall. Respected, beloved believers, brothers and sisters, those of us that are seekers of knowledge, according to Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, a quarter of your religion is attributed to the marriage to Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says one quarter of the adab and the ahkam of the Muhammadan Sharia is transmitted from that young woman radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha. Sayyidatu Aisha radiallahu anha and the Ummahatul Mu'mineen, those Siddiqat, right? A Siddiqa bint a Siddiq. What are a Siddiqun? The kibar, the elites of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People occupying the station of haq yaqeen. Yaqeen, certitude, is of stations. Ilm yaqeen, certain knowledge. Ayn yaqeen, certainty like sight. Haq yaqeen, true certainty. For those of haq yaqeen, the unseen is seen. Sayyidatuna Aisha is one of them. Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha saw Jibril alayhi salam. Who were you talking to? You saw him? I saw him. That was Jibril. Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, Jibril would come to Allah's Messenger beneath the covers of her bed, radiallahu anha wa ardaha, and she would perceive Jibril alayhi salam. Imagine that. That is a marriage. That is a marriage. The archangel bringing the revelation of the Lord of the heavens and the earth to the very bedroom of that married couple. Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha, she perceived the angel of death when he came to ask permission to take the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's soul. And she knew that that was other than Jibril. That's not how it is when Jibril comes. Who was that? That was the angel of death asking permission to take my soul. Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha al-Habib al-Mustafa passed to the highest company, leaning against her chest. And she said, on her day, in her quarters, and Allah combined her saliva and his saliva. She moistened the siwak, he used it, and it passed on after having chosen the highest company. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi sallam. When he passed, he left her from the greatest of the theologians, jurists, judges that this community has ever, will ever see. One of the seven who gave fatwa at 18 years old. Knowledgeable in the genealogies and the idiom of the Arabic language. An herbalist. She knew medicine. She died knowing knowledge of the religion, died knowing the literature of her people, their genealogies, died knowing medicine, radiallahu anha, or he died and she knew medicine, radiallahu anha. How was that? He would get ill. Prophets are tried. So the Bedouins would gift herbs to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this herb for this ailment, this herb for that ailment, and by that she learned the medicines of those aboriginal people, and properties would speak to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and inform them of their properties, and by that she gained medicine, knowledge of medicine as well, radiyallahu ta'ala anha wa arda'a. And she narrates what will transmit in closing of this next chapter of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She narrates to us his most difficult day. She asked him, did you ever have a day that was more difficult than Uhud? Did you ever have a day that was more difficult than Uhud? And he said, I was faced with what I was faced. I was confronted by what I was confronted by from your people. And I was not confronted by a day that was more difficult than the day of Aqaba. What was the day of Aqaba? And Aqaba is not the Aqaba of the days of Hajj or the Aqaba of the bay'ahs of the oaths that will follow, that's at Mina. And he mentioned that he offered himself to the nobles of the city, the tribe of Thaqif and the city of Ta'if. And that was that after the death of Abu Talib, the persecution of al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa intensified. When did we have, as stated yesterday, Sayyidina Abu Talib and Sayyidina Khadija radiallahu anhum passing in Ramadan of the 10th year. In Shawwal of the 10th year, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went seeking possible refuge and protection to convey his revelation to the city of Ta'if. And he approached the nobles there, Abdi Alil, his brother Mas'ud, and their brother Amr. Right, these three brothers who were nobles their brother Habib bin Amr bin Umair bin Auf, these nobles of the city of Thaqif, and he said, they didn't respond with what I wanted. They didn't just not respond with what he wanted, they rejected him violently. They insulted him, and they turned the idiots of their town and the youth of the town against him. And he was stoned, driven out of Thaqif. His head was split. His legs were lacerated. When he would slip from being stoned, they would grab him by his biceps and lift him back up till they lined him up between two lines and stoned him and drove him out of town. That's what he described as the most difficult day. So then he said, I went forward, mahmum ala wajhi. I went forward in a state of grief, just in the direction before me, until I came to a place called Qarn al-Tha'alib, and I looked up and there was a cloud. And in that cloud was Jibril and the angel of the mountains. He said, they both greeted me. And they said, your Lord heard how they rejected you and what they said to you. And your Lord has sent the angel of the mountains that you give him your command. And the angel, after greeting him, he said, if you wish, I'll smash them between al-Akhshabain. Imagine, each of us has enemies. Every one of us has enemies. Every one of us has had our feelings hurt. Imagine if you could destroy your enemies in an instant by smashing them between the mountains that surrounded them. Ibn Hajar said, this is the mountains of Mecca. What do you think he said? Did he say, smash them? That's not nubuwwah. He said, no angel of the mountains, I hope that Allah will bring from them their offspring those that say, La ilaha illallah. His da'wah was to their offspring, not just to those that were rejecting him. And also on this day of Ta'if, he made his famous du'a. And we encourage everyone to memorize this du'a. Everyone to learn this du'a. Learn this du'a. Make this du'a when your feelings are hurt. Make this du'a when people don't receive you well. It's a du'a that's full of, what could we say, tafweed. Of placing affairs with Allah, surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree, adab with Allah, and seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's good pleasure, a dua on the day the mountains shook. And that dua is, and with this will close, Allahumma ilayka ashku da'afa quwwati wa qillata hilati wa hawani ala nas. O Allah, to you I complain of the weakness of my power, my little strength and mine being deemed as insignificant among people. Ya Arhamar Rahimin, Anta Arhamar Rahimin, Wa Anta Rabbul Mustada'afin. O most merciful, you are the most merciful and you are the Lord of those who are weak. Ila man takiluni ila aduwin ba'idin yatajahamuni, O ila sadiqin qariban malaktahu amri. To who will you turn us over, O Lord, to a distant enemy that will be adverse to us, or a near friend that you've given them power over our affair. In lam takun ghadbana alayya fala ubali. If you're not angry with me, O Allah, I do not mind. In lam takun ghadbana alayya fala ubali. Ghayra ana afiyataka awsa'u li. However, wellness from you is easier for me. A'udhu bi wajhika alladhi asrakat lahu dhulumat wa sala. A'udhu bi nuri wajhika alladhi asraka lahu dhulumat wa saluha alayhi amru dunya wal akhirah. We seek refuge through the light of your face, through which all darknesses are illumined and the affairs of this world and the next are rectified. And yanzila bina ghadabuk, O yahillu alayna saqatuk wa lakal utba al uqba hatta tarda. We seek refuge in you, Allah, that your anger or your wrath descend upon us. Ya Allah, Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Bijahil Habib, we continue to seek your pleasure until you're pleased with us. Walak al-utba al-uqba hatta tarda. Walak al-utba hatta tarda. Wala hawla wala quwwata illa bik. And there's no power or strength except through you. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Excuse me.